Day out for this occasion. It's not the most pleasant occasion we've ever had in Belhaven. Hospital, as the pastor just said, was built and put in service in 1947. That's a long time ago. That's many, many years that those founders have helped provide health care to this town. We need to know each one of their names, but it did something that was very important to our community. It saved lives. It's like the local EMS now, that if somebody's standing by the phone when you call, they save lives. That's a big deal, and this hospital is a big deal. I have had family members at that hospital many times, like all of you. I had a grandmother who actually was a nurse anesthetist there for about 30 years. So I've always had an acquaintance with a hospital. I've also had a son that I've taken to the emergency room before that wasn't breathing and was limp. Now what if I had to take him to Washington? Or what if I had to take him just over to Dr. Jones's office, or Dr. Beamer, or Dr. Boyett, and that was it? That's the kind of stuff we're facing. That's what's looking us in the eye. Economically, the hospital has been an asset to the town for years. It's provided jobs, good paying jobs in town, the best paying jobs in town. And it's going to be a terrific impact to us to lose our hospital. The hospital has always had ups and downs. Anyone that's lived in Belhaven for very long knows there's been times where the hospital seems like it's going to fail and then it would come back. And the reason it would come back is because community leaders, people, citizens of the town, citizens of the area would donate money, donate their time, raise money, and make things better. Well, about 18 months ago, I heard that Vidant was going to buy our hospital. I didn't know if it was really a good thing or a bad thing, but I certainly felt like it wouldn't go out of business. They certainly seemed to have deep pockets. I think everybody thought it would bring stability to our community. But you know what? I started having some concerns, and that started when Biden came in and bought up the doctor's offices and the practices. All of a sudden, they completely controlled our health care. They had all the say, and that's what they have today. And we're talking about all the say with 20 to 25,000 people's health care. Now, in government, you know, you like to see competition, but when it comes to health care, there needs to be some rules against things like this taking place. Then we started to see some actions that made us concerned. There were volunteers at the hospital for years and years. It was a big part of the hospital. And I had a volunteer come to me and say they weren't being treated that well at the hospital anymore. Well, I thought, well, maybe they just got a new procedure over there nobody likes and it'll go away. Then I had my own run-in with the hospital. Everybody knows about the dockage at Winds Gut, that the town spent $250,000 on dockage over there to improve the town, to make it inviting to the boating community. A lot of work went into that. A lot of people were involved in that. Well, not long ago, a boat came up, tied up to the hospital's bulkhead, and the man abandoned the boat. So the boat's sitting there. When people come to our town and they look at our beautiful dock, just to the left is a sunken boat. So I talked to the hospital and I said, why don't y'all do something about that boat? They said, we've talked to our legal department. That boat is not our problem. And I knew right then we were dealing with people that didn't have any regard for Belhaven and its well-being. You think if you were the hospital or if it was your business, you would certainly want to get that out of the way to help the town. They had no regard at that time. That sent off alarms in my head. On Monday of this week, I received a call from WITN telling me of the rumors that the hospital would close. Now, really, I didn't take them all that seriously. You know how rumors start. People start on me all the time, and 99% of the time they're not true, so I don't pay them a lot of attention. Well, anyway, I called the manager of the Belhaven and Washington hospitals, and I asked him what was going on. And he told me there was no decision made at the time, so there was nothing to tell me. So then all of a sudden I became concerned because obviously there was discussions going on. And I was completely and totally shocked that there was no involvement being asked for from the community or the town government whatsoever. They're dealing with an issue that is so vital to all of us and had absolutely no concern for what we thought about our health care. If truly their goal was to save our hospital, they would have been communicating with the town government, with the citizens, trying to figure ways to make it work. I'll submit to you, I don't think they wanted it to work. No communication shows there was bad faith by a board that knew all along they were going to kill our hospital. Don't let them let you think or make you think that this just came about in the last 6 months or last year. The board shows just absolutely no regard for Belhaven or its citizens. Basically, the vibrant board is made up of mostly people that live in Greenville, who probably couldn't even tell you how to get to Belhaven. And they are deciding our health care. And they're deciding that we no longer deserve the health care that we've had in the past. One of the things that always blows my mind in politics is when somebody starts lying. Somebody starts trying to say it's not tell you it's night when it's day. All right? You know what they said in the paper? We're going to be better off. Well, let me ask you this. If you lose 100 jobs, are you better off?
No.
Okay. Well, how about a town losing a $450,000 utility customer in a short period of time? You think the town's better off?
No.
Having 100 fewer people coming downtown and eating lunch and spending money every day, are we better off?
No.
Does having to drive 30 to 80 miles to see a loved one in a hospital sound like that's a better deal?
No.
Poor people not able to visit loved ones because they don't have a car, can't find a ride to Washington, are they better off?
No.
Some people, they say to the 100 people they're going to lay out of work, don't worry. If we have other openings, we'll put you in them. That's lip service, and everybody knows that. Every one of those employees knows that. That's all that is. And are those people, if they do get a job in Greenville, Washington, are they better off now that they have to drive 30 miles or 50 miles to work every day?
No.
It's amazing what's taking place. I wanted to read you a statement here. This out of the Washington Daily News. Vidant said, as services at the hospital are shut down, they will be offered at Area Vidant Medical Group physicians' offices. Those services include specialty clinics, 24-hour day care, laboratories, radiology, and physical therapy. Now, I'm going to ask you all. Now, they think we live in Greenville and we don't know anything. I bet everybody here has been at least two doctors here in town. Have you seen them have 24-hour day service? Well, why do they think we're going to think they do? They said, I repeat, as services at the hospital are shut down, they will be offered at Area Vidant Medical Group physicians' offices. Now, let's picture your son getting in a car accident. His ankle's broke, his arm's near about detached, and the rescue squad picks him up. Where are they going to take him? To Dr. Jones's office? this is. This is serious. And these folks are over in Greenville right now, drinking tea, playing golf, whatever they're doing, and they don't care. And we've got to make them care. And the only way we can make them care is by getting the word out about what they are doing. Now I'm going to go back again. Are we better off? Are we better off if someone you love has a health emergency and they don't have an emergency room to go to and they're going to a doctor's office?
No.
Let's think about it. A car accident, a snake bite, a heart attack. How would you like to have a heart attack and your only help here in town is to go over to Dr. Jones's office and wait for the helicopter to come, I guess. And what can Dr. Jones do? I don't know. Dr. Jones, Beaver, Boyette are great doctors. We all love them. But they're not geared for this. This is why you need a hospital. This is why you need an emergency room.
Yeah.
Someone should ask the Vidant CEO, Dr. Herman, how he would feel if somebody shut down the Greenville Hospital. You reckon they'd be upset?
Oh, yeah.
How about if somebody just went up there and closed it and didn't even tell anybody and said, oh, by the way, all y'all are going to be out of jobs in about 4 months. You reckon they'd be upset?
Yeah.
Well, evidently they don't think we're going to be upset. That's reality. That's not spin. I haven't spun anything. I haven't used a tricky word. That's what's taking place here. Vidant needs to know that we fully understand what they've done to us. I'd like to read part of the IRS description of a nonprofit. Quote, a nonprofit organization must not be organized or operated for the benefit. Checked out pretty good. The top 15 executives at Vidant make $9.5 million combined annually.
Wow.
15 men are making $9.5 million annually working for a nonprofit.
Wow.
Nonprofits like the Red Cross, you know, the Chamber of Commerce, they're making 9.5. Now let's think about that for a minute. Now I know these men are important, and I know they're very smart. But do you think they're more important and smarter than the President of the United States? Probably not. Just a guess, okay? I would think the President of the United States is pretty important. There's people in Syria right now concerned about what he thinks, so he must be important. When he wants to go somewhere, they crank up a 747 to carry him somewhere. He must be important. You know how much money he makes a year? $400,000. Okay? Now, let's take that $9.5 million. Let's give the CEO of Vidant the same salary the President of the United States has, $400,000. And then let's give the other 14 men the salary of the Vice President of the United States. That will total up to $3,646,600. If we take that away from the $9.5 million, that would leave, if they were just paid at that rate, it would leave $5,853,400 for health care in Northeast North Carolina. That would pay 97 registered nurses an average of $60,000 a year. And we would definitely have a hospital down the street. But they're thinking about that bottom line, and they're thinking about how much money they're making. And they want to make more. And even though something could probably be worked out at Belhaven, it might not be a great profit center, but you break it even, they're not interested in breaking even. They want to make a killing over there. And that's what full profits are for, not nonprofits. Nonprofits have endorsements from the government. They have special tax treatments. And for them to use a nonprofit and be shutting down health care in Northeast North Carolina is wrong. Morally wrong.
Yes, it is.
They keep the big checks and we lose our hospital. We are at the mercy of a greedy nonprofit who is making immoral decisions to pad their bottom line. That's what's going on. In America today, we're experiencing what it's like to be ruled by a dictator. A dictator doesn't ask the community what they think about anything that's going on. A dictator only makes decisions based on his interests. In Belhaven now, we have a dictator and it's Vidant Health. They're going to decide what health care you and your family have from here out. People who can hardly tell you how to get to Belhaven are deciding what health care our children are going to receive. I submit to you once again that they knew they were going to close our hospital when they bought it. They didn't communicate with us because they didn't want it to succeed. And do you know why? Because the people who were going to that Belhaven hospital, they wanted to send them to Washington. The reason they wanted to send them to Washington is because Washington's struggling. So by taking the people in our beds here and sending them to Washington, it makes Washington stronger. And to heck with Belhaven's quality of care. were being pushed to the side. They bought our hospital to shut it down. Now, where do we go from here? The first thing is Vidant needs to communicate with the town and community. I saw two real estate men from Vidant today, and I said, you all have done great damage in this town, and still nobody is coming to talk to us. Nobody's explaining what's going on here. We don't know what kind of coverage we're going to have after you close the hospital. Nobody's talking to us. It's bad business. Also, the town never needs to be without an emergency room. And you know, it would just be great for Belhaven to have some common respect come from Vidant Health for the people down here. They think we're a bunch of people walking around in a daze and don't know what's going on. And if you all didn't come out tonight, they would still think that. Other communities across North Carolina, particularly Northeast North Carolina, if they hear Vidant's name, they need to see how fast they can run. Because what they're going to do is come in with no regard for your community and do what paths their bottom line. They don't care about the people. They show it. If they cared about the people, they would at least communicate with folks and let them know what was going on. They don't even do that. So once again, I'm very sad that we have to gather like this today. I'm going to ask County Commissioner Hood Richardson to come forward. He's got a lot of experience with hospitals. He's actually the chairman of the remaining board at the Burford County Hospital.